Traditionally, a process will have a single thread of execution. This means there will be a single flow of execution within the program. Your process will be assigned single program counter register that will point out to the next instruction in your program that will be executed by the processor. So there will be only one flow of execution in your program. However, consider having multiple program counter registers per process. If we are having multiple program counter registers against one process, then this means there would be multiple flow of instruction executions within the program. That is, multiple locations can start executing concurrently. This is called multi-threaded application. So multiple threads of control defines a multi-threaded application where a program can start execution at different locations concurrently. So far, the process that we have discussed, they have a single thread of execution. In the coming lectures, we will discuss that how multi-threaded applications are designed and what are the relevant characteristics that need to consider while designing multi-threaded applications. So if an application or a process is multi-threaded, in that case, there would be more information in the program process control block. That is, multiple program counter registers will be stored in the process control block to represent these different threads against the process. Process states. As process executes and it progress during execution, it changes states. A state represents the current process activity within the system. The process may be in either one of the following states. New state, this is that state when process is being created. Running state, this state defines when program instructions are being executed by the processor. Waiting state is defined when process is waiting for some event to occur. For example, might be it is waiting for the input from the keyboard. So when the process is waiting for the user input via keyboard, then we will call our process is in waiting state. It is not doing anything at that time. It is not being executed at time. Rather, it is in waiting state. It is waiting for the event to occur. And what is the event? Event is user will press some keys and those keys will be transferred to the process. Then there is a ready state. Ready state is defined when process is waiting to be assigned to a processor. That is, process is in the main memory. However, it is not under execution. It is waiting for the processor. Might be processor is busy at that time with some other process, and our process is waiting for the processor that it gets free, and then it starts executing this process. Then there is a terminated state. Terminated state represents when the process has finished its execution. This figure shows interaction between the progress between various stages, that how a process progress from one state to the other state. Initially, when a process is being created, then it is in the new state. And after that, process has been allocated memory, then it will come into the ready state. From the ready state, this means that process is now residing in the main memory and it is waiting for the microprocessor for execution. From the ready state, process will move to the running state. And from running state, during execution, there is possibility that either process has finished its execution. In that case, it will simply move to the terminated state. There are two more possibilities. One possibility is that an interrupt has occurred. Maybe our system is connected to some network, and network card has received some packet. So network card will generate an interrupt. So as we know that interrupt has priority, and whenever an interrupt arrives, it must be processed, and current process should be stopped to process this new incoming interrupt. So when interrupt has arrived, process execution will be suspended, and it will be moved from running state to the ready state. And after that, when the interrupt has been processed, then again process will resume its execution. It will go back from ready to the running state. The third possibility while process is in running state, that is some IO event wait. That is, during execution, process has generated some system call, for example, maybe to receive input from the keyboard. So in that case, process will no more execute. It must wait until the input becomes available. So in this case, again, process will move from running to the waiting state. In waiting state, process will be simply waiting for the input to become available. And as soon as input becomes available, or whatever the IO event was under consideration, that IO event has completed, it will again move from waiting to the ready state. Remember, it will not go directly to the running state. From waiting, it will come to the ready state, and from ready to it, ready state, it will move to the running state. Okay, do you have any idea that why process is not going directly from waiting to the running state? Any idea? Okay, remember, in multi-programming environment or in time-sharing environment, when a process is waiting for some IO event, then processor doesn't sit idle. When one process is in waiting state, it comes from running to the waiting state, its execution is suspended. It is blocked, right? And it will be in the waiting state. Now, at this time, processor will not sit idle. It will start executing the next available process. So another process will be in the running state at that time. So that's why this process, upon the completion of IO, cannot go directly to the running state. It must wait now until the processor becomes available. So that's why this the state transition is from waiting to the ready state. Okay, process scheduling queues. During its execution, as the process execution progresses from one state to the other next process state, a process moves in different queues, depending upon that in which state at that time the process is. The purpose of the scheduling queues is to maximize the CPU utilization and quickly switch processes onto the CPU in time sharing environment. So operating system maintains different scheduling queues like job queue, ready queue, and device queue. Job queue jo hai, this queue contains all the set of processes in the system that are in the job pool.
ये जॉब पूल का कॉन्सेप्ट हम जब मल्टी प्रोग्रामिंग डिस्कस किया था उस वक्त हमने किया था कि जॉब पूल जो है ये क्या होता है। दिस इज जॉब पूल जो है इट कंटेन्स ऑल द जॉब्स आर ऑल द प्रोसेसेस इन द सिस्टम डेट आर वेटिंग फॉर द मेमोरी एलोकेशन, जो कि मेन मेमोरी एलोकेशन के लिए वेट कर रहे हैं। तो इनिशियली प्रोसेसेस जो हैं दे माइट बी इन द जॉब पूल बिकॉज मेमोरी इज नॉट करंटली अवेलेबल एंड दे आर नॉट दे कैन नॉट बी एलोकेटेड मेमोरी इमीजिएटली, सो दे मस्ट हैव टू वेट इन द जॉब पूल। सो सेट अप ऑल द processes in the system which are in the job pool that are assigned to the job queue, and from job queue operating system selects a process and assign it the main memory. So the next queue is the ready queue. Ready queue has all the processes which are residing in the main memory, and these processes are ready for execution and they are waiting for the processor so it becomes available, and as soon as processor becomes available they start their execution. And obviously, there must be some mechanism to choose a process from the ready queue, because in ready queue there are many available processes. And same is the case with the job queue, that in job queue there are multiple processes that are waiting for the memory allocation. So there must be some mechanism to choose that which process will be shifted from job queue to the ready queue. And similarly, there must be some mechanism to choose a process from ready queue for processor allocation. The third queue is the device queues. Remember, there are different peripheral devices attached to our system, and every device has corresponding device queue. So device queue jo hai, it contains all the processes which are waiting for this particular IO device. Like in time sharing environment, there are multiple users which are using this system, and might be at any given time different users have requested for the printer device. So at any given time, only one such request can be handled by the printer. So the rest of the requests, they will be assigned to the device queue of the printer. So device queue contains all the processes which are waiting for this particular IO device, so it becomes available and that process can start using this device. Remember, a process migrates among the various queues during its life cycle. Like as we have discussed, that initially processes will be in the job queue, then they will be shifted to the ready queue, and maybe when they are waiting for the IO devices, they are in the device queues. So during its life cycle, a process will migrate between these queues. Okay, this figure shows the ready queue and the various other device queues. The first queue is the ready queue. The header of this queue has two pointers, head and tail. Head pointer points to the PCB7. PCB7 means that there is some process, PID 7, process 7 jo hai, and head is pointing to this process PCB. And tail jo hai, the second pointer tail jo hai, it is pointing to the PCB 2, process 2 ke PCB ko ye point out kar raha. And all these PCBs are also linked with each other, they have pointers to each other. So currently this means that in ready queue there are two processes, process number 7 and process number 2. These two processes are currently in the ready queue. Or process number 7 jo hai, this is at the head of the queue, and process 2 jo hai, it is at the tail of this queue. Then there is another there is a device queue, that is magnetic tape unit 0. This queue is empty, it has null both for the head pointer and the tail pointer. This means that no device is waiting for this magnetic tape unit 0. Similarly, there is another magnetic tape unit 1. It is also an empty queue. No device is waiting for this tape unit as well. Okay, next there is a disk unit 0. Now there are three processes which are waiting for this disk unit. PCB 3, process control block 3, process control block 14, and process control block for the process number 6. So three processes are in the queue, and PCB 3 is at the head of the head of this queue, and PCB 6 that is at the tail end of the queue. And again, these PCBs are linked with each other through pointers. A linked list might be used to implement these queues. Okay, finally, there is a terminal unit 0, and terminal unit 0, jo hai, it has only one process in the queue, that is process number 5. And we can see its PCB, process control block number 5. So because there is only one process in the queue, so both head and tail pointers are pointing to the same PCB. So this figure gives us the idea that there are multiple I/O device queues, and there is a ready queue as well as there would be a job queue in the system. And a queue will contain all the processes which are at that particular process state. Okay, process queuing diagram. Okay, in this queuing diagram, it shows that what happens to a process. Initially, we can see that a process is admitted to the ready queue. Yani from the job queue, it moves to the ready queue. And from okay, process queuing. This diagram shows that initially process has been admitted from the job queue to the ready queue, and from ready queue, there are different processes in the ready queue which are waiting for the CPU allocation. Now there is some mechanism by which a process will be selected from the ready queue and it will be allocated CPU. Now there are different possibilities when it is in running state, that either it completes its execution. In that case, if it completes its execution, it will be exited from the CPU. The other possibilities include that while running, process has made some IO request, and if it has made some IO request, in that case it will move to the IO wait queue. And IO wait queue belongs to some particular IO device. This circle, IO circle, represents that this is the resource, IO resource, that will be assigned to the process from this queue. And once the process completes its desired IO operation, then it will be again shifted to the ready queue. Okay. The third option, third possibility here is that when a process is in the running state at the CPU resource, then time slice expires. Remember, in time sharing environment, each user process is given a certain amount of time to execute on the processor. And this time period is known as the time slice or time quantum. So when this time slice expires, then again, process will be CPU will be taken back from this process, and this process will be shifted to the ready queue. The next possibility is that while a process is running at the CPU, this process creates a child process. So when process has created a child process, now it waits for the child termination. It is waiting that first child terminates, then it will terminate. So when process is waiting for the termination of its child process, then again it will go into the waiting state. So it is again assigned to the waiting queue, and when child terminates, then it will come back to the ready queue. The final possibility while a process is running at CPU, that is, some interrupt has occurred and this process is waiting for that interrupt. In that case, it will go to the interrupt wait queue, and when interrupt has been processed, then this process will come back to the ready queue. Okay, schedulers. Scheduler is a component of the operating system that selects among the available processes for next execution on the CPU. Like we have seen that processes which are ready for the execution, they are stored in the ready queue. So from the ready queue, there are different processes in the ready queue. Now there must be some mechanism, and this mechanism is known as scheduler. Scheduler is the part of the operating system that selects a process from the ready queue and assigns it the CPU so that it could complete its execution. Now there are different type of schedulers. The first one is the long-term scheduler. It is also called job scheduler. Job scheduler kya karta hai? It selects which processes should be brought into the ready queue. That is, it selects a process from the job queue. Abhi humne queues discuss ki thi, unme ek job queue thi. Yani wo queue which contains all the processes which are in the job pool. Ye wo processes hain which have not been assigned main memory. Jo bhi main memory ki assignment ka wait kar rahe hain. So long term scheduler jo hai ya job scheduler jo hai, it selects the selects a process from the job pool or job queue aur usko ready queue ko assign kar deta hai, yani isko main memory assign kar deta hai. The next scheduler is the short term scheduler. Short term scheduler jo hai ya isko hum CPU scheduler bhi kehte hain, it selects that which processes should be executed next and allocate them the CPU. यानी ये ready queue में से एक process को select करता है और उसको CPU assign कर देता है. Remember, there are some operating systems that don't have long-term scheduler. They only have short-term scheduler. या जिसको हम CPU scheduler कहते हैं, ये इनके पास सिर्फ वो ये होता है. Another distinction between long-term scheduler and short-term scheduler is the frequency of that, how frequently these schedulers are invoked. Short term scheduler jo hai, this scheduler must select a new process for the CPU frequently, because a process may execute for only a few milliseconds and then it might go into the waiting state due to some IO system call, theek hai, yeah, maybe its time slice has expired, because the duration of a time slice is also in milliseconds. So after few milliseconds, time slice will expire and this process will go from running to the ready state. So that's why short term scheduler is invoked very frequently, because it has to select a process from the ready queue and it has to assign processor to this newly selected process. The reason that this scheduler is invoked frequently, so it consequently it gives us the idea that this scheduler must be fast enough, because if this scheduler is slow, it will take considerable time to select a process from the ready queue, and obviously the time that it takes to select a process from the ready queue, during that time CPU is not doing anything, our processor is idle, and this is simply the wastage of processing resource. So that's why scheduler component of the operating system is very performance critical component. Short-term scheduler must be very fast so that the CPU doesn't sit idle. It doesn't waste any time. The long-term scheduler is invoked very infrequently because long-term scheduler, what it does, it selects a job from the job pool and assigns it the memory or assigns it the put it this process in the ready queue. So because there is there are very long gaps between between different processes that a user might start an application, then after a few minutes it might start another application, and then it might take many more minutes before user start some third application. So long-term scheduler jo hai, because it is dependent upon the invocation or you can say the creation of different processes, and creation of processes depend upon the users, that either user wants to create a process very frequently or might be user is having long time lapses between different between the creation of different processes. So that's why this scheduler might be slow, and even if it is slow, it will not affect the performance of the system. Another attribute of the long-term scheduler is that it controls the degree of multi-programming. Degree of multi-programming. Multi-programming, as we know, multi-programming means having more than one processes in the main memory is called multi-programming. And what is the degree of multi-programming? This means how many processes are stored in the So long-term scheduler, it controls the degree of multi-programming, that is the number of processes which are residing in the main memory. Long-term scheduler jo hai, it must select a good mix of IO bound and CPU bound jobs. Why it should do so? Because if this scheduler selects the IO bound processes only, then the ready queue will be mostly empty because these the processes which this scheduler has selected are IO bound processes, and most of the time these processes are waiting for the IO devices, so they will be in the IO device queues, and that's why ready queue will be mostly empty. CPU will sit idle. And obviously, CPU is not doing any useful work during this time. On the other hand, if this scheduler picks processes which are CPU bound, in that case, our IO devices will go unused. And again, system will be unbalanced. So long-term scheduler must carefully select a good mix of CPU bound processes and IO bound processes. So that neither the ready queue remains empty, nor the IO device queues remains empty. All the CPU resources, all the system resources are being properly used. No resource sits idle. Okay, another scheduler is the medium term scheduler. Few operating systems, they also introduce this scheduler. The purpose of this scheduler is to overcome the CPU contention. So in time sharing environment, to overcome the CPU contention, medium-term scheduler is introduced, or mid-term scheduler is introduced. This scheduler, it reduces the degree of multi-programming. How it reduces the degree of multi-programming? because this scheduler, it removes the process from the main memory and shifts it to the virtual memory. This is how it reduces the degree of multiprogramming. Now, because when it removes a process from the memory and shifts it to the disk, then obviously there are less number of processes in the main memory. So that's why degree of multiprogramming has been reduced. Now, the question is why it will do so? Why it shifts a process from the memory and moves it to the disk? It does so to overcome the CPU contention, because in time sharing environment, multiple users are using this system and every user might be having many more applications to execute. So there is a CPU contention. These users and these applications are competing for the CPU resources. And obviously, main memory cannot hold all the user processes at any given time. So some of the processes must reside in the virtual memory. So that's why midterm scheduler, it selects a process and it moves it to the disk storage. So this figure gives us the idea that newly processes are admitted to the ready queue. From the ready queue, these processes are assigned the CPU, and from CPU, there are three possibilities: that when a process is in running state, then either it completes its execution and it goes to the end. The other possibility is that during execution, this process has made some IO system call. So in that case, it will go to the IO waiting queues.
And the third possibility is that this process is moved from the CPU to the disk. So this is known as swapped out. So process is swapped out. It is moved from the CPU to the disk, and where it remains for some particular time duration. And again, when the memory becomes available, then this process will be swapped in.